Okay, great. Welcome everybody to the May 18th, 2023 Digital Equity Learning Network of King County meeting. Thank you for joining us today. We will be talking about the King County Digital Equity Plan that we'll be working on lots of worksheets and having some discussions together today. So thank you for being here. We promise to have exciting discussions and chances to fill out worksheets. So what could be better than that? If you're not already a member of DELN, sorry, Dave, I should have prompted you. If you're able to put the link in the chat of how you can sign up, we have a listserv. If for some reason you're not on the listserv, it's free. It's not super active in the sense you'll get like a million emails a day. You'll get anywhere between 0 and 7 or 8 emails a week, I would say, depending on the week. And we talk about when all the meetings are coming up and all of that. So if you have not signed up for our listserv, please do so. It's a great way to find out stuff and you can post stuff there as well. I'm also excited to say we have a new website, which we just launched. And David, yet again, do you mind putting that in the chat? Sorry, I did not have that queued up to put in the chat and should have asked you ahead of time. But we do have a new website. So if you go to our old website, it should link you to the correctly new website. And we're
digitalequitykc.org, I think.
Yep. So if you want the website, it is there. And then we can also, on that website, you can figure out how to sign up for our listservs and all the information you would want to know. If there is any information you would like on our website, you can also let us know that. We are always happy to add information, especially resources, to our new website. So great. So with that, I will actually turn it over to David. And let me know when you want me to start the slideshow. I can do that now. And I will turn over to David Keyes, who is with the City of Seattle.
Yeah, thanks. So we should double check that website. I was just trying to put it in quickly. I didn't have queued that up either. So let's check that. And maybe if we have time then to just show a little bit of the website. For one, I'm really excited about it, and I think folks will find it a little nicer to move around and, you know, let us know if you have resources to add to that also. Some great stuff with that. Let's see. And so we're going to do a little work, and I'll just do a little set context here. Again, this will take me just a sec to kind of get the link up for folks, for me to get to the screen up as I'm maneuvering around PowerPoint to Zoom here. Okay, so just a sec, let me just go ahead and share screen. And take a second. I'll go ahead and just use this version anyways, just for time's sake here. So we're going to be doing, we've been working on the countywide broadband and digital equity regional plan. And that's going to, you know, set priorities for us for the countywide region. And then that's going to tie back in. In March, just as a kind of a quick note too, we spent some time talking about a couple things about what people thought were kind of important things going forward. And a little bit of what we heard, and Priya Singh is on the call here too. So she's been looking at some of the input that we got and has started working with us on this project. Some of you were part of the breakout groups that we had. So So there was, you know, some comments that people needed sufficient broadband and laptops, some comments that Chromebooks don't always work. You know, I think there's a balance on this wanting quality and affordability. And then in general for programs, you know, a thing to emphasize on our plan and as we work on getting funding from the state and looking at the long-term goals for sustainability, that the need for continuity, that one-time funding doesn't always work, and the digital literacy program and device replacement needs to be supported. And then just the digital navigator programs need to speak the language of the populations they serve. So have local community culturally based digital navigator programs. There's some additional comments there. This is just a kind of a short snapshot on some of that. And we'll have more of that as we go into the responses and the worksheets. So we have sent out requests to many of you, and if you haven't had it, and maybe Priya could put some of the link in. King County has since put up a website and has links to the format that the state is using with a set of worksheets to fill in input. And we're using a combination of those worksheets and using our discussion here to fill that in. And again, just kind of a note that what that's heading to is the state broadband equity access and deployment program, the BEAD program, and the Digital Equity Act programs. And so the majority of the BEAD is going to broadband deployment, and then with some aspects around workforce training, but that's focused on primarily on broadband deployment, and we get into details about that. But the Digital Equity Act is the piece that has a broader scope around internet devices, skills, accessibility. And so the state is working on, again, on this sort of state planning to put into place a plan. And then we'll use that state plan to apply to the feds to get a state capacity grant, which they will then distribute to local communities. So that's one piece of funding down the road that we're working on, this countywide plan to feed into that, to help set priorities for what's in the state plan, and then ultimately what priorities there are that the state applies for and what projects the state applies for its capacity grant. And basically the state plan needs to be done by the end of the year, but we have this first deadline of getting materials in June 14th, and I'll talk about that in a sec. And then there's the competitive grant, which will be a later round coming from the US Department of Commerce that organizations will be able to apply for separately from what the state grant does. So in essence, there's two streams of funding that will be coming down. So, and then we'll have 5 years for implementation on the state capacity grant for that, and 4 years on the competitive grant. So our goal is, again, to feed into the state broadband and digital equity plans in this BEAD 5-year plan, and then the digital equity plan to influence that funding. And so then just kind of for reference, we're in this outreach collecting community feedback. And then very soon we're gonna start to populate the worksheets that are required for this and a summary plan report. So we'll be doing some of that analysis, starting that almost immediately, but then folding in the input that you guys contribute through these meetings and through completing those worksheets that King County has posted. And Jessica, yes, we can share the slideshow out as well. So we'll send it out to the digital equity, to the DELN list after this.
Yeah, and we'll put it on the website also.
Yeah, great. So there's sort of two discussion questions we wanted to try and take on today. And let me just note what those are, and we can just pause for a sec for questions before we launch into that. So one of them are what are possible workforce planning solutions? And the second question is going to be, what are possible policy solutions to accelerate digital equity access and adoption? And I know those are fairly broad questions. Those are the kind of two that we're going to spend some time tackling today. These in our PowerPoint, we also have links to those worksheets and how you can help by providing feedback directly and kind of more comprehensive input from your organization and the constituents you serve. So we'll send that out as well. Just to kind of note, then I mentioned these worksheets, share them around, share that link to the county site. People can go there and click on them too. We have sent out the request to do that on the DELN list, and we can send another one out. And then we're available for some office hours to get help with those worksheets as you're working on them. So there's a link you'll see in the PowerPoint, and we'll post on the website, on the DELN website. And then just to note, there are the state has contracted with a company called Guidehouse, and they're setting up some state listening sessions. So June 6th, I think, is going to be an in-person one, probably at the Burien Library. That's just being confirmed. And then they're going to have also a couple virtual sessions to listening sessions to participate in. And there's more on the state website. So let me take a pause before we come back to these questions to discuss today, just to see if there's any broad questions or anybody else wants to chime in here on that.
I have a question, David. This is Joanne. When's the soonest we're going to actually see some money from all of this? Is it 2024? My read of the information is that's when the grants are going to show up. I mean, all this planning is lovely, but meanwhile, we have programs that need to be sustained.
Yeah, I'm totally with you on that. others may know the detail on that a little bit more, but yeah, it's basically 2024 will be okay. When the dollars will start to come in. So part of it is getting the state. So the state will submit their proposals at the end of the year. Yeah, it's going to be 2024 to mid 2024. I mean, there is some money in the state budget for digital equity. So we know that the state passed less than last time, but they've got at least $15 million per year for digital navigator programs. And they're just getting the details on what was passed in the state budget that's going to the broadband office, where there may be some additional funds coming out for digital equity. So we may see some money coming from the state budget that starts in July coming out sooner. But the main thing is, yeah, that's lots of getting this stuff in to not an immediate return. So.
Okay.
And
thanks
the more,
for confirming.
And I would say one of the things that I think we keep seeing and hearing is that the more we can take this and build in specific projects that would help with the dollars it would take to do it and get that queued up, that's going to, I think, speed up our ability to get projects implemented from the state. And get on the map of the applications that the state puts in. Good question. Anything else? Okay. Let's see, I can't see offhand how many people are here if we want to do this in breakout rooms or
just... We have 20 people here.
Throw it out.
My gut is that we could probably do it in one room considering the number of folks who are here on behalf of the program.
Yeah, well, let's do that then. Okay. So we'll start and kind of aim at, you know, about 15 minutes or what it takes, and just to give us time to go to the second question on policy. So let's start to throw this out about what our
possible. So David, I would suggest if you could maybe copy and paste those into the chat and then stop sharing your screen, then we'll actually be able to see each other better because everybody's pretty small when you're sharing the screen.
That is what I was just about to do. So
great, thanks.
All right, so there's the first question I'll put in the chat there.
I also wonder, since this is a fairly small group, if we could do a round of introductions. Is that okay with everyone? I don't know that I'm really asking. I need a round of introductions, so I'm going
to... Great, go for it, Priya. Yep.
Hi, I'm Priya Singh. I am a consultant, and I'm helping the county and the city put all of these pieces together for their plan that is due on June 14th. We're going to hear the words June 14th a lot, and that's cemented in all of our brains together. Okay, to others.
I didn't really introduce myself, so I'll do that quickly. I'm Shira Rosen. I'm with Literacy Source and also with DELN. So I help kind of MC these meetings or whatever it's called, and write a lot of the emails when you hear about the meetings coming up and stuff. So if you email DELN, I'm probably looking at that email. Why don't I pass it to David so you can fully introduce yourself, and we'll just pass it around until everybody's done.
So I'm David Keyes, Digital Equity Advisor at the City of Seattle IT Department. Should we go to Daryl Hunt next?
I'm Daryl Hunt with King County IT. We've engaged PRR and Priya to help us pull all these pieces together. And we're trusting that we're going to have an excellent report that will really showcase the programs that are needed for digital inclusion and the budgets that are also needed to help those efforts. Thank you for your help and support.
And Delia Burke.
Hi, everyone. I'm Delia Burke. I'm with the City of Seattle on the digital equity team.
Great. And Joanne Donahue.
Hi, everyone. I'm with Sound Generations, and we offer a number of digital equity programs through our senior centers.
And Minduk.
Hi, everyone. I'm Minduk Nguyen. I'm the executive director of Helping Link, which is a nonprofit serving Vietnamese American.
Great. And Aisha.
Hi, everyone. I'm Aisha Bamani. I'm the digital equity program manager for Seattle Public Schools.
Great. Alice Lawson.
Hi, all. I'm on the team with David and Delia at the City of Seattle, and I focus on wireless affairs, so working on the wireless aspects of these telecom systems.
Great. And Shell?
Hi, everyone. I'm Shell Lasaka. I work for Hope Link. It's a community-based organization on the east side, and I'm part of the digital literacy program.
Great. And Chris, you?
I am Chris Yu, and I'm part of Evergreen Goodwill, and I'm part of the digital equity team.
Great. And Doreen Cornwell.
Cornwell. So I guess I work a lot of projects through the Star of Seattle, which is a community technology center based in the Seattle Housing Authority community, with particular emphasis on the needs of people with disabilities, accessibility issues. And also, I spend a lot of time with some other transportation and affordable housing issues. And then I ask a lot of questions, but I want to hear everybody else's introductions before I go on with questions.
Great, thanks, Doreen. And Elise?
Hi, everyone. I'm Elise. I'm a consultant. Yeah.
Apologies, I pushed something strange in my computer.
Okay. And Elizabeth?
I'm Elizabeth Yokia, Workforce Development Adult Basic Education Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. She, her pronouns.
Great. And Jessica?
Good afternoon. I'm Jessica Hilburn. I'm the Project Manager for Goodwill Connect, representing Evergreen Goodwill Northwest.
Great. And Don? John Morrison Winters, are you there? Go on to Joni, guys. Oh, there's John. John, we can't hear you. Okay, let's go on to Joni and we'll come back.
Hello, everyone. My name is Joni Gutierrez, and I'm I work with Evergreen Goodwill, and I'm new. This is just my third week on the job. Right. I'm the Digital Equity Technology Specialist, and I'm glad to be in this meeting. And my mind is an empty slate, so I'm all ears.
Great, and Maria.
Muted.
Sorry, I was talking. I'm Amir Su and I work at the Seattle Housing Authority.
Great, and Laura?
Hello? And I work on the digital equity team. Great. All right, thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Laura Lowe. I'm the program manager for Find a Ride, which is part of our one call, one click system at HopeLink, which is a trip. Oh. We're starting with a trip planner, and I started about 3 months ago. It's really exciting, kind of merges a lot of transportation, healthcare services, as well as digital equity. There's also a navigator component.
And Marisol?
Hi, everyone. My name is Marisol Tabehopper with the Workforce Development Council of Seattle King County.
Great. And Mira?
Hello, everyone. I'm Mira Jo. I work with David Keyes at City of Seattle, and I oversee our technology matching fund grant.
Great. And Nadia?
Hi, I'm Nadia Brown. I'm the Outreach Program Manager and Outreach Hotspot Lead at the Seattle Public Library.
Great. And Sabrina?
Sure. State Digital Equity Lead at WSU Extension. And I'm coordinating the King, Pierce, and Thurston counties' involvement in this. So while I'm on the DELN steering committee, I'm sort of hanging back just to make lots of space for your unique answers to emerge.
Great. Great. And then John put in the chat, he's part of our team at the City of Seattle IT department. Great. Thanks, everybody. Good job. Okay, so as we get back to then this workforce question, and maybe we could also work to put in a link to the specific worksheet so people can see that in context. But I mean, I think just hearing kind of who's here as well, that as we think about digital equity and workforce solutions, then you know, I think we have what's interesting and potential here is what we might have in our county plan and talk about the need around different aspects of the pathways around workforce training. So I think with that, we'll kind of throw that out for what do you think is important to put in to our plan to strengthen at your own organization or sustain at your own organization and in the community you serve. I put you on the spot for a second, Jessica, because I'm just in there because I know that you know what Seattle Goodwill does with workforce training is pretty big. So
Sure. I mean, if we're to think about this globally, right, what infrastructure needs to be in place for us all to deliver digital equitable services, it's broadband. And my understanding in the little reading I've done since being kind of thrust into this work is that we're anticipating a shortage of workers in the broadband sector. And so I think it's a unique opportunity, right, to come all together and be focused on this one thing and to provide jobs for folks in a way that's sustainable and offers living wages for local communities. And so, you know, I'm just kind of starting this research process of what is out there as far as that specific sector training. And there's not a lot in our area. So I think that poses an interesting question, you know, for us all. And then if we were to like bring the question down to a smaller level, of course, yes, we've been doing digital equity work for since the 80s, really looking at computers in the workplace and how do we scale up our workforce to be prepared for the next technology. And, you know, it's not much different than what we were offering in the 80s through our free computer classes, but just keeping the content, the curriculum relevant. I'd be curious if this group is aware of any broadband type training and what does that look like for an individual that is looking for that type of work? Is it a one-year program, certification program? What's the cost?
So that's interesting to say what you're saying in part, and I might turn to Alice for a second because I know she's been doing a little bit of work with a training program Verizon's putting in. But as we think about then, part of what I heard you saying is having increasing opportunities and for programs that skill up for work in the broadband field, right? And I'll just plant a seed, you know, the other pieces then that skill up for AI and so on. But Alice, is there anything you want to, if you want to just share anything about, I know that at least that one aspect that Verizon is trying to do some training with others or skill up.
Yeah, thank you. I said another call. Two providers have been supporting local programs. Verizon was one, and they've got some support for a program that was running out of South Seattle Community College to get people the skills to be network technicians. And then T-Mobile is particularly funding $150,000 towards 10 scholarships for Seattle area residents to participate in a program that's a full service. So it's training, it's certifications, and it's job placement. And that's something Marisol has been a great supporter to for us to try to outreach to make sure we do get residents taking advantage of those opportunities. They're all very focused on getting people with skill sets, fiber splicing, tower technicians, tower, not necessarily in Washington State, the big climbing up the towers, maybe bucket trucks, those kinds of things, but it's the physical infrastructure that's needed to roll out these network components for what we call the 5G fifth generation wireless networks. The good news is a lot of it is, again, fiber work, and fiber work is actually backhaul for these wireless components, but it's the foundation for broadband. So to me, We want a diverse workforce, and we want people that haven't traditionally been represented in our especially the field construction crews in telecom, which is a lot of BIPOC and women are significantly underrepresented in those areas. So these programs are targeting towards that. Let's resolve it as we have this new investment and money for these new networks to go out to get more people to participate in and get the jobs. So I put out actually just this morning a message about a lunch and learn on Monday for the T-Mobile supported program, but anyone can reach out to me with more questions on those. Thanks.
And I will say too, I think what's needed is additional, I think, an employer engagement strategy in terms of creating those pathways and opportunities and really that paid apprenticeship model, which is why I think this opportunity with T-Mobile, the Learning Alliance, what we're doing is the first cohort of 10. We're looking at expanding that beyond this 10. Once we have this first program start in early June, we're going to be assessing not only the success, but also really the intentionality of making sure BIPOC workers are at the center of having access to these jobs. But in addition to that partnership and what's happening at South Seattle, we also, I think, need to have a strategy around employer engagement and creating the workforce that we need to have access to jobs in telecommunications and what it will take to build the infrastructure and the workforce that is necessary, across, the Seattle King County region. And I know that's one of the questions. Question three, what are the possible workforce planning solutions? And I would say we probably need some sort of group or task force to be dedicated to this specific, not issue, but I think need to really start thinking about the jobs of the future and what it will entail to upskill workers and reskill workers so that they can have access to these jobs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one interesting thing that's come up in overall in terms of what we put into the plan is where we put in the combination of both what specific programs are needed in support for programs or strengthening of programs, but also what structural things may be needed. So, your point about maybe a piece of what we put into our county plan should be kind of the strengthening of the who's doing the matchmaking, and the coordination for identifying what programs are available and where, how to refer people, how to strengthen those public-private community partnerships.
Yeah, and larger than this, I will say too, we need to have state agencies involved in this process because a lot of the funding is coming to the state, but also how do we leverage other sources of funding? So when this funding comes, we can be leveraging WIOA, we can be leveraging other workforce dollars, There's really, it's gonna require, I will say, at the state level, some sort of strategizing in terms of how we wanna tackle the workforce development plan that needs to be submitted within the BEAD program. They have the five-year plan that needs to be submitted this year. And within that plan, the state also has to submit a workforce plan. So this worksheet, it will help inform some of that, but there is a greater task for the state to submit a workforce plan. And what's the plan there to start having these conversations and really start strategizing around that?
So we'll take a few more minutes on this one. Also, just feel free to put stuff in the chat if people want. And we'll, we hadn't created a Google Doc or something for people to post into, but we could put that up afterwards for people to stick comments in. But feel free to put something in the chat and chime in. What about a few others? Your thoughts in terms of the workforce piece?
So this is Doreen, and I feel like this is a really broad question because I absolutely think some career paths for the physical infrastructure are important, but what else is important as far as, for example, Marisol's point about developing funding sources? And part of why I even asked this question is I had a conversation a couple of years ago with a young woman who was involved in organizing to develop a levy with the Burien school systems to support their digital equity. And so when I, you know, when I think how important like getting people in the schools engaged is, kind of want to have some kind of plan that says, what do different kinds of schools need, or where are they now, and where would they, you know, what did they identify as steps forward? The other thing I want to say is, I spend a certain amount of time online saying, you don't have to have a computer science degree to be a coder. I know lots of people who get different kinds of education and wind up doing some kind of IT work. And so when I think about integrating digital equity things into the workforce, I think there's a kind of right-sizing about helping people identify what tools will meet the needs of your population. Or it's not just what tools, it's what people skills. It's, you know, if you're a senior who's never touched computers, ordering on Amazon is a big deal. But if you have a social network where somebody orders for you, what are the like, you know, sort of privacy and personal life issues that need to come up? And sort of throwing that out there, I don't know where I would put it in a plan, but I'm wondering if anything I said resonates for anybody else.
Anybody else? I just stuck in the chat, and I think we'll try and move on to the next topic. We can always come back to this one. You know, various, the identification we had done about digital skill, various pathways. So from this kind of the gateway and life skills, parent engagement to different kinds of employment skills. So that's strengthening the digital equity skills for certainly is again in STEAM and prep for college and career, and then within work, the sort of digital skills for employment foundations, which I know some of you teach, and then applied tech skills for like retail point of sale or dental technician, those kinds of things, and then specific tech industry careers, which is a broad setup. So as we're looking at equity, that's just a framing we've used and identified some. So, and I know some of you have different elements of that, and the pathways for limited English speakers to learn ESL and basic job skills. So maybe there's some comments to strengthen that piece of the getting into the workforce and starting positions as well on this. Okay. The second question we had, which we thought workforce was a broad one. Let's try this one. So the second question on potential paths forward to work on is what are the possible solutions to accelerate digital equity access and adoption? Possible policy solutions. And so what would make that easier? I know that I'll just kick that off a little bit. As we heard from comments in the March meeting and have heard many, many times, that the one piece just in terms of funding is this multiple year funding. To provide for continuity that would help accelerate equity access and adoption. What are other things that you start to think about as that comes to mind.
Sustainable funding versus living from one grant to another, which is what we're doing right now. So it's an ongoing need because the technology keeps changing. And so, you know, sooner just feel like you understand your phone or your laptop or whatever device you're using, and then they change the software and then you're back to square one, especially for people that didn't grow up in the digital age, speaking certainly on behalf of older adults. So
Joanne, as you're thinking about that, and you mentioned software, you mentioned devices, training. So when you think about sustaining a program, having the funding to do that, is that things like being able to offer, you know, like one thing that came to mind for me is that being able to offer, when you give somebody a laptop, to be able to say, yeah, you can come back in 3 years and replace that laptop. That's one example. You may have others.
Yeah, for us, it's just the ongoing support for older adults. The devices are less of an issue, but I know for other populations, that is the case. It's just the knowledge to stay on top of the ever-changing technology that's out there.
Mm-hmm. And so is that particularly emphasis needed in staffing? I mean, I know that's often the biggest part of work, right? And I know we lose a lot. We lose a lot when we lose people, mm-hmm. community and navigators and so on. Thanks.
David, this is Maria Ursua. Can you hear me okay?
Yep, you sound great.
Thank you. With the Seattle Housing Authority, and one of the things that I think that will be really helpful in terms of sustainability and adoption would be to make it a separate allocation for individuals, especially those that live in either, public housing residence. I work for the Seattle Housing Authority, obviously. For public housing residents or housing choice voucher, give them as part of the policy and infrastructure, give them a separate allocation for internet connectivity devices and to ensure that they are able to access those services. That would be a good way to implement the policy. And I know there's been a lot of efforts around the nation to do that already.
So you're saying to be able to fold into other funding, other support programs for residents to have that allocation to the individual household or individual?
Yeah, so that could be folded in terms of coming down through either housing authorities to have a separate allocation where individuals can access that that resource. Like I know for me, I believe it's Medicaid, there's like a technology component where older individuals can access, have a separate allocation that they can access for devices. Okay. And the issue is not necessarily the devices, but having the staffing to distribute that. So for those in public housing or housing choice voucher programs to have that available through the housing authorities to make sure that they have that resource. And I know that David, around the nation, they've been working on an effort to make it a utility allowance, but whatever it is, either through that or just a separate allocation, I think that would be really helpful.
So I know, Department of DSHS at the state included in some of their contracts to providers at least at the beginning during COVID for the providers for immigrant refugee resettlement support to include technology in their in the contracts that they did with organizations. So maybe there's other kinds of programs too. We mentioned utility, you mentioned housing. So maybe one of the policy changes then is the allowance for that kind of support in the other programs the state is doing.
Yeah, something similar. Maybe we can, find out more specific language and I can send it your way, David.
Yeah, concepts, that's good, okay. Mm-hmm. Others, thoughts here?
This idea of access, David, I think it's really important. So it's one thing to have this money come from federal and state level, but their processes have to be inclusive also. And I'm thinking specifically about the federal benefit of the Affordable Connectivity Program. The application process, I don't think is culturally responsive. And you know what I'm hearing from my digital navigators in the field is that a lot of clients they're serving know about it, have applied, and then just given up because it was rejected, and they don't understand why, it's complicated. And so I think we have a responsibility to demand, you know, simple and low threshold processes for our folks to access the money that's available.
So this is Doreen, and I agree about the barriers for the Affordable Connectivity Program. I think in general, there's an aspect of just day-to-day user support. And I'm really ruthless about telling people, call tech support for your product. Not because I have high expectations that tech support will do what's needed, but because tech support needs to know how people use their product. And especially if it's people who aren't using the most current equipment, who find it really frustrating when the interface changes, but you know, week to week sometimes. I think there's gotta be a kind of continual dialogue about that. What's the other thing I was going to say? I also think that, you know, I don't know what authority who has to do things like make sure that when multifamily housing goes in, that there's no lockout, that people have a choice about what broadband they use in their building. And I think that's particularly important. I was talking to somebody yesterday and we were talking about there's a low-end $10 a month plan that people can get through the Seattle Public Schools, but it's really not adequate. And this person said, well, I found a really good deal from another vendor that meets our needs. And I feel like to the point about, I think the figuring out, including cost of broadband or cost of connectivity and like utility allowances and how DSHS figures things is really important. I think there was a bill before the legislature last session, not this year, that was aimed at getting people online. And there was huge pushback from DSHS because they said, we don't have the skills to support this. And there were other pieces that weren't really lined up, but what skills and infrastructure need to be updated at different levels of government for people to be able to meaningfully do things online, meaningfully provide services, recognizing that you still need the phone connection and you still need the human, and not minimizing the value of the human pieces of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. just wanted to hear, is it Shell or Chris, are you from HopeLink? Another Goodwill and HopeLink, just trying to, wondering, you know, what would reduce barriers that would enable you to accelerate digital equity access and adoption?
Yeah, that's a great question. I feel like for our program, we are still just kickstarting it off. It's really new. We're in development and in the hiring process and trying to put in place access to the future instructor to have components of one-on-one time with people who need help with digital navigating and things like that. They're not quite a navigator because their role is instruction, but I feel like having that component is really important in having that barrier lifted, because I feel like everyone was saying, human interaction in this communication, I feel like would really help alleviate some of the stresses that people might be having if they're getting all of the information from a website and it's hard to ask questions and it's not user friendly. I think that's another component, is being user friendly.
So even in putting in a program, then, I mean, you're saying in part that the policy piece, you know, in some ways is recognizing that we need to support and put first these human interactions, the human support. And sometimes that's a portion of a different position that's helping, and not just a specific allocated digital navigator, but the ability to do digital navigation and help within another position.
Yes.
Right. Are there other things as your in support that you feel like you need as your you know, starting to build this journey on digital equity?
Yeah, I'm still really just gathering information on what's available and trying to be a great listener into the room and just seeing what's happening and kind of shifting that into the program as it happens. I'm still at the very beginning stages, so I don't really have so much to contribute. Like I said, we're in the hiring process.
Okay. Well, it's certainly part of what the Digital Equity Learning Network is doing too, to support each other and try and do that. All right, we just have a couple minutes left. So any other kind of last couple comments? Libraries, schools, other orgs who are here?
David, yeah. I think one of the key thing for us is that having the material or the resources or the trainer being able to have bilingual material, because it's, you know, it's difficult with the language barrier, but when it comes to technology as well, it's combined the challenge, and it's very hard for people to learn when they don't have the confidence. And so I think that, you know, it's great that we're trying to bridge the gap for everyone to be able to access technology, but I most often the translation or the bilingual resources are not there.
Great. All right. Yeah, Elizabeth, anything you want to throw in here? Okay. All right. I think I just wanted to, let's see, maybe Priya, can you just remind folks of then kind of what's going to happen between now and June 14th, how people can get help, and just a reminder what folks are doing?
Why, I'm happy to do that.
Great.
We are looking for a couple of things. First is for folks at your organizations to go to the King County website, look at those worksheets, fill them out, pretend you're in elementary school again, and that worksheets are your most favorite thing ever. They are all digital. That helps us feed our report, and we can say, you know, these are from our community organizations. If you are interested in being a volunteer to help draft or to help review or be a subject matter expert as we're putting the report together over the next couple of weeks, also let us know. And if you need help, we have office hours, and all of those links will be coming to you in Shira's follow-up email and on the King County website. And thank you to those who have already done the worksheets too. We really appreciate it.
Yes, thanks so much. And Sabrina, I saw you put just a note. There is a kind of a late May digital equity summit that's happening in Wenatchee, I believe, and online. Thanks, Joanne, for doing yours. So just want to point that out. And we'll send out info on this state listening session too when we get that. So. All right, Shira, turn it back to you.
Yeah, I was just going to, are there any other announcements? Anything else anybody wants to say? All right, if we don't have any announcements, then I guess we will say thank you for coming and participating in the discussion. We'd love you to still fill out those forms. So if your organization hasn't, please do. Priya is definitely taking all of the information. So great. It was nice to see everyone. Have a nice day. It's actually sunny in Seattle again, in the Seattle area. So enjoy the weather, and we will see you again in July.
Thanks all.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody. Bye.
Thank you.